have before us the opportunity to forge for ourselves and for future generations a new world order, a world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations. When we are successful, and we will be, we have a real chance at this new world order, an order in which a credible United Nations can use its peacekeeping role to fulfill the promise and vision of the UN's founders.
What is at stake is more than one small country. It is a big idea, a new world order, where diverse nations are drawn together in common cause to achieve the universal aspirations of mankind, peace and security, freedom, and the rule of law. Out of these troubled times, our fifth objective, a new world order, can emerge. Now we can see a new world coming into view. A world in which there is a very real prospect of a new world order.
Okay, shalom. I and I, Rastafari, have some good news. Well, first, let me thank everyone that's actually taking the time to actually watch the video. And I ask of you a favor to watch the whole thing and spread it out. And this is for everyone in the world, African, especially Africans, the whole continent of Africa, everyone, all Africans scattered throughout the world, and all native peoples that are in some way or another affected by these dilemmas, these issues. Well, they're not issues no more, but we ourselves have continued allowing them to be issues. Now, George Bush, you probably just saw that clip. He was bluffing. He bluffed, but we fell for it. But now we're gonna overstand. We're gonna overcome this. Now, this is an invitation to all human beings. You know. Now. Even aliens, you know, even aliens from distant fallacies, like in that one Lion of Judah video, you know, like in this is an invitation to all people, even if they come from make-believe land and different galaxies or fallacies, errors and logic. Let's come together. This is about unity, Africans especially. I need your support and break that. Break the distrust and division, and we're not conquered, we're just divided, you know. Let's come together and I'm gonna express how Africa is more than just a small country, you know. It's a big idea, you know. It's now let's get into this Law of the Jungle. Check it out. It was a book, and then there's a movie. This is their definition. Now, this is the law of the jungle, as old and as true as the sky. And the wolf that shall keep it may prosper, but the wolf that shall break it must die. As the creeper that girdles the tree trunk, the law runneth forward and back. For the strength of the pack is the wolf, and the strength of the wolf is the pack. So, just wanted to throw that in there. It was interesting. Now, another thing, that same author, there's some good Gentiles out there, because, I mean, listen to this. This is a separate poem, nothing having to do with the Jungle Book, which is the same author. Some knew what was going on. Well, most knew. Let's not get into that. There was also foreboding in the poem, so a sense that all could yet come to naught. Far called, our naives melt away. I'm thinking out loud, my bad, but there's something to melting away, and I just can't receive it right now. Forgive I for that. On dune and headland, sink the fire. Low, they would say, I guess. All our pump, lo, all our pump of yesterday is one with Nineveh and Tyre. I really don't know how to pronounce that. Judge of the nations, spare us yet. lest we forget, recessional. It says at the end. Let me read that again, because I did a... Okay, let me just read it again. Far called, our naives melt away. On dune and headland sink the fire. Lo, all pomp of yesterday is one with Nineveh and Tyre. Judge of the nations, spare us yet, lest we forget. We forgot. We forgot. His Imperial Majesty is victorious, triumphant. Rastafari is Earth rightful ruler. And we forgot that. We just forgot. We need to claim our dominion. That's it. We got to take this back. And it just, you know, I was doing some meditating. You know, all thanks be to Jah, the Most High, Creator that is good, almighty, and powerful, you know. We're like this. It seems like, you know, this is kind of like time. It's like His Majesty was victorious, and then we forgot. So we got to come back up here again, in a sense. We forgot. We won. We won a long time ago. But we're not acting like we did. So that's what this video is mainly trying to express. I'm going to just throw in some scripture. Because the glory be of the Metzav Kedus, Book of the Seven Seals. We're going to go to Psalms 133. It's a Psalm of David. In fact, it's interesting because I'm not fluent in the Ethiopic, but I like to practice. And this is one of the Psalms that I was only trying to promote education, that we need to learn that new language, because His Imperial Majesty, he clearly says that well, it's not him that says it, but in the interview, the Lutheran interview, it's declared that all official Ethiopian business is done in the official language. So I took that opportunity to just practice the Ethiopic, but it was this psalm right here. And so let me behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. How good and precious to dwell in unity. World, I'm not going to say this or that. Africa. I'm going to call the world Africa. This is, I just thought about that right now. It's like, I could speak for myself. Some people might not like that idea, I guess. I don't know why I said that. But yeah, it's a new idea. It's a big idea. Let's not divide. So let's consider the world Africa, because His Imperial Majesty is Earth rightful ruler. So, not that we're going to call it Africa, like, officially, but in this little lesson, Africa, African peoples, I'm talking to the world, you know, any human being. And if you're a human, then you apply to this. Africa is more than just a small country. It's a big idea. Ethiopia, my bad, Ethiopia. So, yeah, I guess let me just read the whole thing then. Psalm 133, Song of Degrees of David. Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. It is like the precious ointment upon the head that ran down upon the beard, even Aaron's beard, that went down to the skirts of his garment, and the dew of Hermon, and as the dew that descended upon the mountains of Zion. For there the Lord, Jah Rastafari, commanded the blessings, even life forevermore. Oh, whoa, you know, it's what it is. So let's start a dominion. Let's get into this. Now, a lot's going to come from this book, this little book. Are you, you know, do you have the stomach to handle it, you know? It's sweet, but then it's bitter. Not that it's the book that they speak of in Revelations, but it does apply. So, let's remember this. Oh yeah, I wanted to mention, let's remember the Sabbath, because this is just an idea, personal idea, but it has to do, it's some research I did a long time ago, but it seems to be the Sabbath. This is the Sabbath, like the era, the time in which we're in, because in the Ethiopian, you know, in the Hebrew calendar, it's like the year 5000 and so on, 50 or something. I'm not close, don't hold I accountable. I can't recall it. But in the Ethiopic, it's going towards the evening of the Sabbath day. And so let's remember the Sabbath. This is where we rest. If if I and I wish to look upon it that way, you know, and with further research and study, I'm learning, just, you know, I'm learning all this. I don't claim to know all, but it's an idea that has been in my notes for a while. Like, it just comes up that it just makes sense. Whenever I'm reading, I can't prove it right now, so it's just an opinion, but hopefully Jah willing proven fact in time, you know. And the 8 days, I don't know, I just feel it, but I and I need to go on and be able to prove it, you know. So that being said, let's go to, well, many may not have this little booklet, but I'm gonna read from it. It's interesting, this ain't even mine, I bought that Kebra Nagast a long time ago, and I really didn't like it. Not that the more advertised commercial one. I thought it was the real deal. So some brother, you know, that brother really does travel the world. He don't have a home. He just travel, you know. And so he just lent me this one, and he took the Kebra Nagast, and this is how I and I acquired it, and I give thanks. And so, well, there's so much. I mean, let's start with give me just 1 second. Like I said, I didn't prepare for this, but I just want to get it out, because so everyone watching, Ethiopia in particular, everyone, you know, regardless of our differences, let's unite, let's come together for this purpose in which I am about to explain. You may not want to accept the humanity, the divinity, the truth, the reality behind His Imperial Majesty Haile Selassie, but inevitably, if you choose to side with I and I, you're going to have to live out His teachings regardless if you want to accept it or not. But, which reminds me... Now I know what I wanted to start with. Okay, this is the problem that I am here to address. The fact that we succeeded in laying the foundation of our unity was due primarily to the desire of all Africans to unite in a common struggle against colonialism, poverty, disease, and ignorance, which are enemies of Africa, of this idea. It's not a continent, it's a bigger than that idea, you know, like Bush even clearly said it, but he twisted the truth at the end, with the rule of law. You know what law is. If you're rich and famous, law is pretty good for you, but if you're like the common people, law isn't that fantastic. So let's shoot for the law of His Majesty, which is glorified in the Holy Scriptures. Now, so we're confronted. I can't stress how important, I can't stress upon all the eyes out there, every viewer, how important it is to understand that our enemies are colonialism, poverty, disease, and ignorance. These are the enemies of Africa. But our unity, the foundation of unity has been laid. Let me just mention, I come from both an American background and a Mexican background. Mexico is a product of Spanish imperialism, as well as all of South America, all of the Caribbean islands. Even India was a product of, not that it didn't exist before, but the nowadays what is perceived to be. For example, I could only speak for Mexico because I can relate to it in a sense. While they're destroying themselves with infected narcotráfico or whatever, narcotic trafficking, whatever, they have all the people just killing each other, you know, for drug wars, and it's getting ridiculous. I mean, you can't be outside of your house at when the sun is going down, if it's 5 o'clock and that city, that's the law to not be out. And I'm not talking about the law of government. I'm talking about the drug dealers. You know, they run the country. Well, I don't want to get into that because a lot of people get offended, and I didn't prepare for anything like that. But let's just say that government, U.S. and drug dealers are all kind of like inner. Well, the governments are instigating this so that while we kill each other, like so in Africa, and of course Africa has been more extreme, and I is aware of that. That's why Africa is the example, because the rest of the world can learn from what's going on in Africa. And I'm not saying that let's not be like Africans, because no, let's be like Africans, because Africans have the best example. And the best example is in and through Geta Chenai Jesus Christo, Yehoshua HaMashiach, Ben Ha Elohim, the Son of God, that came in the flesh. Via, you know, at least I received it through His Imperial Majesty. You know, that sounds weird, kind of like reverse, but I opened up to His Imperial Majesty. But then I was, you know, rightfully and faithfully, I was directed to Jesus Christo, so that works out perfectly. The Father loves His Son so much that He gives up all glorification to Himself and leads you to the Son, which creates the perfect love. And this perfect love is manifested in a spirit, in the spirit of Jesus Christus. And we are to act in no other way but in the spirit of Jesus. Let bygones be bygones. The enemy is receiving his reward. They're going crazy. They're going nuts. They don't know what to do. The world is changing. Let's not stoop even lower to that, to the level that they stooped, because we're conscious about it. And if we act in such a ways that the enemy has been acting even to this very day, that makes us worse. I even suggest to help our enemies. You know, like, maybe in this book, I can't recall in what section it is, but it His Majesty explains something to how we can still see the lasting effects of this disease. So they're sick, and I and I are come to a healthy lifestyle, which is in the Christian faith, then let's help them instead of, you know, they've hurt us as well as themselves a lot. You know, let's not make it worse. So let's come together. Unity is strength, you know. So, which reminds me, let's go to, I forgot, and mothers and fathers. I know our mother is the Torah and the commandments and all that, and the instruction is of Abba Kiddush, our Holy Father, Father Holy. But mothers in the flesh and fathers in the flesh, direct their kids, and fathers instruct their kids, and most likely you're gonna instruct them to the mother. You see how it relates? You're gonna be like, listen to your mom. We're lazy like that. I'm just messing. But, okay, so it's going to be Proverbs 1. I'm just going to go over verse 8. My son, hear the instruction of thy father. My son, hear Shema, the instruction of thy father. And forsake not the law of thy mother. So mothers and fathers, you play a big role. Kids will listen. Especially if they're younger, you know, I've noticed that they'll be like, they listen, they really listen, like they get it. So if you get them young, you don't have to worry about them when they're a little bit too old, where they've been corrupted enough and their ego has, you know, gone beyond that which it was meant to go. Now, the earth is ours. Oh, let me just, quick note for all the wealthy people, it's not too late if you're rich. And I'm talking about, like, not that you work hard and you have a little extra. I'm talking about, like, rich people, like, wealthy individuals. Share the wealth. It's over. You know, look around. How many people are, it's not a threat or anything. We're not out to hurt you. But think about it. How many people living the lifestyle that you live, do you know? Not too many. So, I think it's time that you kind of consider that it's in your best interest to help those around you, even those that work for you, even everyone that is suffering upon this world, because you're vastly outnumbered. And I, Rastafari, seek discipline and seek the spirit of Jesus Christos, but there's a lot of people that are upset, and I can't speak for them. I know for I, brethren and sistren, we don't seek to do those devilish We don't seek to dwell in the lower vibrational fields, and we seek a higher state of mind. We seek truth, which is love, in and through Jesus. So, but there, you're going to run into a lot of people that might still be very upset. So think about that, you know? It's not, things are changing. You know, my dad, stepfather, he mentioned that he's never heard so much because, well, partly because I don't shut up about it, but he's never heard so much activity in the heavens. And he's kind of like, you know, he's thinking about it. All that force, all that energy, all these planets, you know, it's the magnetics and the gravitational pulls, it's happening, you know. The only thing, since it's not happening like Hollywood made it to happen, people are kind of confused and dwelling in a twilight zone. But it's happening, you know, the shift. You know, everything's gonna work out. And wealthy people, it's a suggestion, you know, help those around you. And us too, here in the United States, we have a big responsibility. We're the only people, not the only people, but we're, oh, check it out. Not that we're the only people that have the opportunity to help, but we are kind of like a child of Africa, because here in the United States, yeah, we make a little bit more money and we have internet and access and all of that, but that's not the key. The key is that already we've grown up in an environment much like an environment of times of old when our people constructed pyramids where they work together. See, you can have a lighter African skinned with a darker African skinned person and mingling with some of even the Gentiles and some of the Asian people and you know, the kids can't see the difference no more, and that's what makes us different. That's why here in spiritual Egypt we have the opportunity to make this work, because we already have been we've lived the experience of working, whether we like it or not, with different shades of colored people and from different areas and geographies, and so that is to our advantage. Let's come together, let's unite, for it will inevitably result in not victory, but the remembrance of the victory. Remember the Sabbath. Let's make this time the Sabbath. Let us rest and let the will of the Father be done. So I'm just gonna go over, very important, whatever happens, happened. So let's get into it. Justice and equality isn't being enforced at all, and I'm gonna get to that, which is extremely important. I have an idea of how to put this into play, and we'll get to that ASAP. Well, let me just add, whenever you differentiate or you differ between a man because either he's light-skinned or black-skinned, you crush the spirit of that man, you humiliate him. Let's not do that. Let me just go to it, because His Majesty, only Him can express it in the words that express it the best. It's not the whole quote, but for as just as a man without means to feed his hunger and to clothe his nakedness can take no pride in his existence as a human being, so also is one who is reviled and discriminated against because of his race or religion and robbed of his self-respect and human dignity. That's deep right there. That's what happens when we, you know, people crouch down, because it's like your humanity is being, you're being robbed of your humanity, you're being humiliated because of a color. It's nothing you can do. If that's all that matters, there's nothing one can do. He can be on top of the world, but you've already stated that you don't accept him for his appearance, and that plays. Let's be more positive, everyone. We gotta pick it up with the positiveness. No, it just came to me, I might not have explained the African scenario. It's not to, just in case, because it's important to understand that since Africa has been, all these injustice and inequality have been implemented so strongly in Africa, Africa serves as the main focus. If the liberation of Africa continues to the fullest, to that which His Majesty intended it to be like, where it's self-sufficient and everything, then the world is going to change. Africa is critical. It's that center point. Africa is a very important focus, I've come to understand, because it's Ethiopia's more than... Ethiopia was the key to think African. Let's think Africa. Let's make it a collective work. This may be controversial to some, and like I said, I didn't prepare, but I hope to bring better evidence. Now, if we raise our voices against injustice wherever it be found, if we demand a stop to aggression wherever it occurs, whatever guise and brand the aggressor as such, and if we do so on a wholly impartial basis, we can serve as the collective conscience of the world. I'm gonna just bring it out right now. Let's speak up. I was thinking about this, and then it just came to me. Okay, if these cops are public servants and they're here to serve us and to provide the best service to us so that we live comfortable, being the inheritors of the old and last testament of our God and Father, and He's not here right now, so I don't want to confuse anyone, but when other people die, they leave their testaments, and you get what they left you. In our case, it's a very special testament because His Majesty did not die. It's just, but He's not here, so the land's ours until further notice, you know, until His Majesty be like, all right, I'm back, you know. So let's take it back. The government systems provide a service. Let's come together and enforce. We have to enforce everything. For example, if you see a cop and he stopped a brother, pull over and let's go secure the rights of our people. Hey, Mr. Officer, what's going on? He's gonna flip out, but he can't do nothing. And if he does, so be it. Let's take it, because that is how we're gonna establish. You see, if we all come together, if these kinds of actions are being done, there's no way that they're gonna keep doing them. They do it because people just turn around and then they walk really fast. Ooh, that's, and they know it's wrong. We gotta serve as the collective consciousness of the world and bring this to know. If someone's making a beer run, it's time to not laugh and say, oh, that he didn't care, it's funny, whatever. Let's close the door and say, look, man, we're not gonna call the cops or anything, but put the beer back, and it's not right what you're doing. We have to enforce everything, because obviously the system ain't doing it, and we need to put the system on check, and that's crucial. It's up to us to be on guard and be like, so that whatever the case may be, if the officer wants to get out of line, there's someone there to be like, hey, I'm sorry, officer, but this man don't seem to be doing nothing wrong, and the way you're treating him and so and such, you know, it forms not only as a collective consciousness, but then it transforms into what I just recently discovered to be collective security. I was meditating and reflecting upon this, and then it came to eye that if you're gonna, here in the valley, Imperial Valley, I'm close to the border, so people cross that border to make money. Whatever they make, it's a whole lot more over there than they would ever make over there, and so they're willing to put up with anything. I don't want to talk about what I think about that. Is it good? Is it wrong? I'm not here to discuss that. What I am here to say is that we create an environment, and it's not just here, I'm sure it's everywhere, where they allow everything to happen because of the necessity for that, for that few, for whatever amount of money, and they feel trapped where they can't say anything even though they know it's wrong. And what I'm here to say is that if there's a collective security, now you don't have to depend on a shelter, and you got money in the bank so you can afford to be fired and then have time to look for a job. That's financial security. Collective security would be like, you're going to go to the office, you're going to stand up for your position because you did nothing wrong, and you're going to go claim your universal human rights, and you're going to let known that you're not going to put up with this because you are a human and you are to be treated with human rights, universal human rights. But we don't do that because no one's going to back us up. But if we have that collective security where, you know, all of my co-workers, it's just an example, all of my co-workers and everyone's going to stand up for me, then I got no fear, because everyone is morally there, you know, they're in that state of mind of morality, like His Majesty spoke for on behalf of the morality of the world, you know, like it's, we got to stand up for every little, we can't let anything slip, nothing. We can't let nothing slip. We gotta speak out, and it's a common thing, even in between families. If someone is doing something wrong for whatever little interest, they keep their mouth shut because they're not willing to sacrifice whatever needs to be sacrificed to establish truth. And we need to end that. We need to just, who cares if it means 20 years in prison? I know it sounds crazy, but so be it. But until we begin to take those steps, just speak out, you know, who cares if you get fired, if you get, well, okay, let me take that back. Until we assure a collective security, no one will get fired. But let's start taking steps towards enforcing the universal human rights. And it just, a whole bunch of ideas just came to me as to how to go about that. And I would just love to stand by an officer and be like, you know, just correct them, and we can. Because they're here to serve us. We're the beneficiaries. We're the inheritors. This is our land. And they're just here to provide a service. And a lot of these officers and a lot of these, the corruption happens because no one stands up for it. But if cops know that people are going to be pulling up to an arrest site or whatever, to back up whatever is needs to be backed up. And I'm not saying just defend. I'm not saying defend criminals. Of course, if everything leads to indicate that this man is doing wrong, then yes, officer, you know, like, yeah, maybe he does deserve to have his little handcuffs tighter because he's trying to put up a fight, but other than that, to secure the well-being and to secure the collective and common efforts, you know, and most of us just want to be left alone. And so something to meditate upon, which is the main issue. So if we all speak up in this harmonious voice, in one accord, let our voices be one and the eye be single. You know, let's all drum to the rhythm of the one drop, you know, because everyone has in common the heartbeat. So, you know, like, we're all related somehow. And we all need to look out for our common interest. And I know the majority of the world has been colonized, and collective security, we can't let this happen no more. Let's speak out, like His Majesty, he says in the 1936 Geneva, Switzerland, that when a poor people or smaller country or something to that effect if they're being oppressed, then it's time for that small country to speak out. Then if, you know, and then later on in 63, and if it's necessary to suffer and die. But we need to start suffering and dying if that be the case. But we don't have to if we all work together, you know. Because no one's going to want to act on corruption if they know that everyone's going to be on their backs, you know. So we got to take this into our hands. It may sound extreme to some people, but I'm not saying to hurt no one. I'm just saying to protect the rights of those around you. And so to set an example, there's good people out there. Ja will handle the rest, you know, if you speak up. I know Ja will back you up, and you just put someone else in the perfect position that happens to be of of a good heart enough to back you up. And so it'll, you know, let's just trust in Jah and proceed, because the victory has, we have been victor for the longest time, but we forgot, you know. Let's reclaim our dominion. Our greatest asset is our unity, and we must exploit it to the fullest. Enough said. The joining together in a unified effort to overcome the perils of nature and the dangers which beset man on all sides is the very basis of society. The lion of Judah society seems to be in a bind. Not really, because I and I got this. So, no need to fear, no need to worry. Let us go on. And the way in which humanity, since the dawn of history, has assured its survival. Together. Come together in a collective cause. Unity. Africa must speak with one voice, ringing out a powerful, harmonious tone. The fact that we succeeded in laying the foundation of our unity was due primarily to the desire of all Africans to unite in a common struggle against colonialism, poverty, disease, and ignorance. The whole world is confronted with these problems. So Africa seems to indicate, to mean the whole world, confronted with these enemies. Each of us depend on the other, can learn from the other, and in pursuing his own destiny will go further and succeed more quickly with others. Communications. I don't have a whole lot of time in the tape right now, or CD, whatever, but unless we have to communicate, it's... People go on Facebook and they talk for hours. We gotta do that. I mean, sorry, but we gotta do that. I know people just waste their time just doing nothing, but still they do it, so they advance more than us. They get to the party because they all contributed and like, hey, where's the directions? Well, I heard this, I heard that, and they make it to the party. So even though they waste their time on nothing, the fact that they communicate allows them to proceed upon their actions. Now, if we implement our programs, let me go into that one. If we act where we may in those areas where action is possible, the inner logic of the programs which we adopt will work for us and inevitably impel us still farther in the direction of ultimate union. Okay, if the tape runs out, I'll try to finish this. It just works that way. Whenever you start trying to act upon something, it's like whenever you start reading something and learning something, then automatically you start to act upon it, even the logic behind it, because you're telling your brain, your frontal lobe, but then the rest of the body's kind of like, man, the frontal lobe's kind of right on that. And you find yourself acting your programs out without even intentionally doing it, you know? Shalom.